Sorry, I'll share my screen one second. Okay. Should I start now? We have, I don't know if I should wait for like a couple minutes because there's students still coming in. Okay, it's officially 5:05. We can start now. So good afternoon, everyone. I'm Bushra Rasheed. I'm a third-year medical student. And I'm going to be teaching you guys CVP histology. So just a review, not really teaching. I'll be reviewing whatever you've done in histolab. I've linked my email in the slide here. So if you guys ever, like if you guys have questions later on, I'm free to take questions during the lecture. Or at the end, I don't mind. But if you have any questions you'd like to send me through email, here is my email. I hope we'll be done in less than 2 hours. Just want to make sure that you guys know. And I'm pretty sure you have like a call session after this. I don't want to take up like all of your time. So an hour and a half, I think, maybe 2 hours maximum. And we'll take a salad break in the middle, inshallah. So this is the table of contents. This is what I'm going to be talking about. I'll be covering the cardiovascular component of histolab of CVP and the respiratory component. So in terms of cardiovascular, we'll be going over cardiac muscle, so longitudinal sections versus cross-sectional cuts. And we'll also be looking at blood vessels, so in the entire vasculature. Okay. So that would be the biggest artery, which is the aorta. So the arteries themselves, arterioles, capillaries, venules, and then veins. In terms of the respiratory component, we'll look at the upper respiratory tract and the lower respiratory tract. The upper respiratory tract consists of the nose, the nasal cavity, the mouth, pharynx, and larynx. But we're only doing the nose and nasal cavity since that's what's most relevant. And the trachea and the lungs will be covered in the lower respiratory tract part. So let's start. Okay, the heart.
The heart is basically this muscular organ. It's the size of your fist. It pumps a blood throughout your body. You guys know everything. You mean, you've done all of this in CVP, so let's just dive right in. Okay. I want to start with the layers of the heart because I feel like it's relevant. Just as, this is just a quick review, a sort of a refresher, so that when we're doing the histology for each of the layers, it's easier for you guys to keep up. So I'm going to be using my laser pointer right here, okay? This is the laser pointer. So the first layer is the endocardium, which is the layer that is the towards the inside of the heart. This is the layer that's in contact with the blood at all times. Then we have the myocardium, which is the muscular layer. This is the actual layer that does most of the pumping of the heart. We have the pericardial cavity, which basically contains lots of serous fluid. The pericardial cavity is sandwiched between two layers of pericardium, which is the epicardium right here. And then we have the parietal layer. So the visceral layer of serous, it's called serous pericardium because again, there is serous fluid within the pericardial cavity. So the sandwich I was talking about earlier, we have the visceral layer of serous pericardium, and then we have the parietal layer. The visceral layer is obviously closer to the heart. Visceral means viscera, so this layer would be closer to the actual heart. The visceral layer of serous pericardium has a special name. It's called the epicardium, whereas the parietal layer of serous pericardium, that's just what it is. That's the name. And then lastly, we have the fibrous pericardium. That's the outermost layer. In terms of connective tissue that's surrounding the muscles, this is again a refresher for the actual histo lecture later on. So we start off with myofibrils right here, myofibril. And when you have a collection of these together, they form a myofiber. And these myofibers would, when you collect them together, they would form a fasciculus. Now the myofibers that are present within the fasciculus right here, they're sort of embedded in this connective tissue. To make sure that they're, you know, they stay in their place, they're not moving around too much. The connective tissue that they're held in right here, that's called endomysium, right here, endomysium. And when you put lots of fasciculi together, the connective tissue that the fasciculi are in would be the perimysium, right here. The perimysium is all of this yellow connective tissue. And lastly, all of these fasciculi form the muscle, the actual bulk of the muscle, and the muscle is surrounded by the epimysium. So endo means towards the inside, peri, and then we have the epimysium. This is a real image, basically. This is under a light microscope. This is not a gross image. You can't see muscle like this grossly. So we're basically looking at a low magnification. And the really, really small units you see here, this is a myofiber. And then the connective tissue around this right here, can you guys see my pointer, by the way? Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, awesome. So the connective tissue right here, this is the endomysium, okay? And when you put all of these myofibers together, this entire unit right here would be the fasciculus. A fasciculus is surrounded by perimysium. Right here. So all of this surrounding structures around these units would be the perimysium. And lastly, when you put all of these fasciculi together, you form the bulk of the muscle, and that's surrounded by the epimysium right here. This is the outside of the muscle. The epimysium actually is continuous with the tendons, so that's something to keep in mind. It's like the outermost layer of the muscles. I don't know how much you guys remember from like foundation and MSK. So again, another one of these recaps. What's relevant to us here is the green one right here, the green plane, which is the horizontal or the transverse plane. We're going to be looking at cut sections of the cardiac muscle. So ones that are cut cross-sectionally. And that's like that's synonymous to the horizontal plane that's shown here. And then the coronal or the sagittal, they're both longitudinal. So it's along the length. So these are the two different sections we'll be looking at in leg cuts of the muscle. This is the first cut. So this is a longitudinal section. What we're basically, I'm gonna use Dr. Annie's numbering. I think it's like very easy to keep up with. And I feel like she's gonna bring this exact same image, and she's gonna be like label one or like label two. So it's like really, it's for the best if we follow her labels. So right here, number one is pointing towards this intercalated disc. Now what that is it's basically this disc that's connecting two different cardiomyocytes together. What it's composed of is like different sort of junctions. So it has like tight junctions, it can have gap junctions. What these will basically do is sort of conduct ions and electrolytes from one cardiomyocyte to the next to help with the passage of electrical impulses. That's the function of intercalated discs. Another intercalated disc right here would be, this is also labeled one. Another one would be this one, then this one. I mean, there's like so many all over the picture you can see. Then we move on to number two. What Dr. Annie's trying to point towards here is the branching of these cardiomyocytes. So you can see this right here. This is one complete cardiomyocyte. However, when it's like advancing forward, this is the point where it splits sort of. So this cell and this cell, both of them originate from one cardiomyocyte. And so this is called branching. This is a feature that's very specific to cardiac muscles. This is not really seen in skeletal muscles. It's not really seen in smooth muscle. It's specific to cardiac muscle, which is why it's like really important to know. Another one would be right here. So this right here, this is the point of splitting. This is one cell and it would kind of split into this and this. Now we move on to number three. We're basically pointing towards the striations here. So if you can see in this entire cardiomyocyte, there's like these lines right here. These are called striations. Striations are present in both cardiac and skeletal muscle, but not in smooth. That's why they're called smooth, because it does not have striations. Striations are present in all of these cardiomyocytes. There's like, you can see lines over here. You can see them literally everywhere, here, everywhere. Moving on to number four. This indicates the binucleation of cardiac muscle cells. So you can see like this this cell right here. This entire thing that I'm pointing at right now is one cell. And within this one cell, you can see one nucleus and two nuclei. Two nuclei, again, this is also specific to cardiac muscle cells, so it's important to know. Number five is pointing towards, so you guys see the structure right here, this really, really thin sort of, it's not exactly a cardiomyocyte because there's no like striations present here. It's like, it's really smooth, this thing right here. So this is endomysium. This is, that's why we were reviewing it earlier. This is endomysium, this is collagen. This is not a cardiomyocyte because it's so smooth. There's like no striations present. That's how I know I'm looking at connective tissue and not a cardiac muscle cell. Number six is pointing towards these nuclei. And this is another way how you can differentiate that this is this is endomysium, is that the nuclei are sort of at the side. This is actually a capillary, by the way. This is an endomysial capillary. So the nuclei are present towards the periphery, whereas like for a regular cardiomyocyte, the nucleus is present in the center. That's another sort of distinguishing factor. So this capillary, the nuclei are pushed towards the periphery, whereas a normal cardiomyocyte would just have them right in the center. And yeah, we're done with this one. Now this is cross-section. Now this looks completely different from what the longitudinal section we were talking about earlier. There's no intercalated discs to see here. They're, because of the cut, the way that the muscle was cut, you can't really see intercalated discs. You can't see any striations. You can't see them branching, which again is like so characteristic of cardiac muscle. You also can't see binucleation. So because the cells, because of the nuclei are present on different layers, if you cut them in a cross-sectional way, you wouldn't be able to see two nuclei at the same time, which is basically what's here and what you see here. And lastly, in a cross-sectional cut, this all look like different or irregular shapes. Whereas if we were to go back to a longitudinal cut, it looks like they're all like uniformly cylindrical, but like they look like they're different shapes in cross-sectional view. Okay. This is a side-by-side comparison of a longitudinal. So this, my left side right here, this is longitudinal muscles, and these ones are a cross-sectional. These are a side-by-side comparison. So everything that we talked about earlier, all of those features are present in this section right here for longitudinal. And again, cross-sectional, they're circular. It's not cut along the length. So you can see the differences. They're very clear. Something special about these cross-sectional muscles, muscle cells, is that they're actually a little bit paler, if you can tell. They're also way larger. This is so much bigger than like this one cylinder, you know? This is actually a Purkinje fiber. This is not a regular cardiomyocyte. So the fact that it's paler, it means that it has way more glycogen inside. And the fact that it's bigger also indicates that it's actually a Purkinje fiber, not really a regular cardiomyocyte. One second, please. So this is the cross-sectional view of one single cardiomyocyte. In terms of its features, we see that the nucleus is right here. It's centrally placed. It's not really displaced towards like the edge. It's not pushed anywhere else. It's right in the center, as we talked about earlier. Then it has like this really clear halo around it. This halo that you see right here, this is actually glycogen. So it has like glycogen stores, again, because like what do muscles do all day? They're continuously contracting, especially the heart. It's contracting all day, every day, for the rest of your life. It's going to do that. It needs energy to contract. And energy comes from glucose, and they have lots of glycogen stores to be able to supply glucose whenever needed. So you can see there's a lot of glycogen here around the nucleus. And then we have the pink things you see here. These are all myofibers. So these are smaller myofibers, whereas these ones are a little bit bigger. So they get a little bit bigger the further away you go from the center of the cell. And this entire thing would be one cardiomyocyte. Now this is a Purkinje fiber. This is a Purkinje fiber cell. And in terms of appearance, it's pretty different from like a regular cardiomyocyte. The nucleus, first off, the nucleus looks like it's way bigger than a regular cardiomyocyte would have. The really small halo that the cardiomyocyte above had, you can see that the white area is actually super huge here. It's so much bigger. So it has the glycogen store here is way, way bigger than a regular cardiomyocyte. The size of the overall cell is also bigger. Let's compare. Look at this cell versus look at this cell. This cell is bigger. And this also has, since the glycogen amount is so much, the amount of myofibers at the end, at the periphery, you can see at the end of the cell, it's very low. So there's more glycogen, there's less myofibers, the cell is bigger, and the nucleus is bigger as well for a regular Purkinje fiber cell. So this is a cross-sectional view of an actual heart. We're not really looking at any section of the heart. This is just like just plain heart. To orient you guys, we're looking from the top of the heart. And this V shape right here, this is the inside of the heart. So this, the number one, is representing ventricular cavity. So this is where the blood would normally be present. Versus number four, this is the outside of the heart. This entire thing is the outside of the heart. Two is basically the endocardium. Three would be the myocardium. And four is actually, in terms of labeling, it would be the epicardium. Talking about the endocardium in a little bit more detail. Number one, we have this, all this empty space is where the blood would normally be present. But since this is a histological sinus, there's obviously no blood. This is the lumen of the heart. Then the immediate layer that's right next to the blood would be this layer right here. This is the endothelial cell. You can see that these cells are actually pretty, let me zoom in. These cells are actually pretty thin. So they're really, really flattened, really thin. The nucleus kind of elongated almost. They're spindle-shaped cells. So this is a squamous cell. The endothelial layer is one cell thick, and it's simple squamous epithelium. A here is areolar loose connective tissue, which is basically just, you know, just connective tissue, but loose and irregular, which means that the collagen isn't very compact. It's like placed further apart. And irregular would mean that it's not really, the collagen is in no particular pattern. It's like haphazard all over the place. And there's two layers of connective tissue present. Sorry. Then we move on to what P says here, which is Purkinje fibers. Again, compared to a regular, number three is the myocardium. So compared to a regular myofiber, a Purkinje cell is way larger. It's paler in color because of the glycogen. It has less myofibers. And yeah, that's how you differentiate between them. The Purkinje fibers in this picture, the location, like location-wise, they're present sub-endocardium. Sub basically, so this is the endocardium. what I'm pointing at right now, this would comprise the endocardium. And P, since it's underneath the endocardium, it would be subendocardium. And then we have the myocardium. The epicardium now. The epicardium is the outside of the heart. Again, we said epicardium was a special name. It's actually a more generic name would be visceral layer of the serous pericardium, but it's actually epicardium. So number A in the picture, the letter A here, indicates the pericardial cavity. This is where all the serous fluid would be, like I mentioned earlier. Serous fluid is needed for a couple different reasons. One of the most important reasons why you actually need the pericardial cavity is to provide mechanical protection to the heart, so it acts as a shock absorber. Another reason that I can think of could be to reduce friction between the different layers of the heart, so to make sure that the contraction is really smooth, really fluid. There's no friction or anything of that sort. Moving on, we have B. That B is pointing towards the mesothelial cells. So what the mesothelial cells are, they're basically these specialized cells that are responsible for secreting serous fluid. So all the pericardial fluid that we said was present in this entire area, this is produced by the mesothelial cells. And it's just one cell thick. It's super, super thin right here. Not more than that. That's it. One layer of mesothelial cells. Then we have C. C is the submesothelial connective tissue. I think it's also... Actually, no, I'm pretty sure. It's also loose irregular. It's also loose irregular connective tissue. So areolar, basically. This is where the blood vessels would be, the nerve supply, arteries, veins, all of that good stuff. And then we have D. This is adipose tissue. So how can you tell adipose tissue on a light microscopic slide is that the cells appear completely empty. Like, as you can see, the cells are completely empty. There's no nucleus, no nothing inside. What the reason for that is that when we're preparing slides for looking at them under the microscope, we're using alcohol, we're using different reagents. Because of those reagents, the fat gets washed away. And the same sort of thing happens for glycogen as well. Glycogen gets washed away, which is why the cell looks pale. Remember how Purkinje fibers look really pale? Most of the glycogen gets washed away. Again, same thing with adipose, all of the fat gets washed away. So the cells are completely empty now. There's nothing inside these, but before we actually prepare the slide, they had fat in them, which is why this is the adipose tissue. And then E is pointing towards the myocardium. That's it. In terms of the actual epicardium, basically from B all the way until D, that's what the epicardium would be. This is where the coronary arteries and veins are also present. Something else you should know from this particular picture is that the vein, you can see the wall thickness is super, super low, whereas for a coronary artery, you can see that it's so thick right here. There's the tunica media, that's very thick. There's muscular layer here. We're going to talk about the blood vessels in a bit, but yeah. Now we're going to look at the electron microscopy of two cardiac cells. So this section right here, the intercalated disc, we're gonna zoom into this box and look at it under the electron microscope. Now, electron microscope is not something that's commonly available everywhere. It's actually a pretty, pretty huge machine. So it's it takes up an entire room's worth of space. That's how big it is. And it's expensive and not commonly available and all those reasons why we don't actually use them. It's also not necessary for the cardiac cells, but just for right now, to see what the organelles are present, I'm going to be explaining. So number one right here would be the intercalated disc. Again, we've already talked about that, how it joins two different cardiomyocytes together, and how there's gap junctions here, which will allow the transfer of ions and electrolytes, etc. This is one cell, this is another cell, and they're again separated by an intercalated disc. Then we have number two, this is a Z disc. And two Z discs, basically Z discs will separate sarcomeres from each other, right? So one sarcomere, two sarcomere, and there's a Z disc in the middle. Then we have number three, which are the thin actin filaments, and number four, which would be the thick myosin filaments. And lastly, number five, which is a mitochondria. So mitochondria are usually present between myofibrils. So this thing that I'm pointing at right now, this is one myofibril. And there's mitochondria here, over here, on either side of it. If you count in the picture, I can count approximately like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. There is 6 mitochondria. Again, like I mentioned earlier, there are so many. There's a lot, lots and lots of glycogen for glucose. There's lots of mitochondria present. All of this for energy purposes. Now we're going to compare the 3 types of muscles that you guys have taken so far. So skeletal muscle versus cardiac muscle. Both of them are actually pretty similar in the sense that they're both cylindrical in shape. As you can see right here, this is cylindrical, these are cylindrical. They both have striations present too, which smooth muscles don't. And those are the similarities. In terms of differences, we can say that skeletal muscles have the nuclei on the periphery, whereas cardiac muscles have them in the center of the actual cell. Another difference can be the intercalated discs, and how they're present only in cardiac muscle cells. And the fact that cardiomyocytes actually branch, whereas skeletal muscles are just like parallel lines. There's like no branching, no nothing. Whereas cardiac muscle cells obviously would branch. There's also cardiomyocytes are also binucleated mostly, whereas that's not really something that skeletal muscle cells are known for. Lastly, we have a smooth muscle cell. You can see the cells are super thin. So it's like a spindle-shaped cell. The edges are kind of pulled. It's almost as if like you take a cell and you just pull the edges and you make it super, super thin. That's basically what it looks like. The nucleus is right in the center. There's no striations, none of that present. And yeah, so for smooth muscles, you can see that each cell is sort of its own thing. They're all separately present. Whereas the cardiac muscle cells, they're all connected. You know, there's like rows and rows and rows of connected cells because of the intercalated discs. Whereas this cell is, it's a separate, completely separate cell. And yeah, I think I've covered everything so far. Okay. Let's now talk about the vascular system. Wait, I want to ask you guys first, do you think I'm going too fast? What is he? Oh, I'm sorry, I just saw. Awesome. Okay, I'm so glad you guys. Okay, awesome. Somebody, I think Sadim asked, what is C? Can you tell me what slide you're referring to here? Oh, somebody answered. Yeah, it's a mesothelium, exactly. So B is the mesothelium right here, the one cell thick mesothelium. And then we have the connective tissue right underneath it, which would be submesothelial connective tissue. Okay. Somebody's like, faster the better. Okay, inshallah. I'll try to finish it really soon, inshallah. Okay. Now let's talk about the vascular system. So, okay, these are the arteries. So I've tried to put arrows. So we're kind of progressing from really large arteries to all the way until really, really small arterioles. The first picture that we're looking at, let me zoom right in. This is basically an aorta. So aortas are basically known for being really, really large muscular and elastic arteries. What you see here is we've used elastin stain. So all of these black fibers that you see here, the black fibers in the middle, these are all elastic fibers. Normally under an H&E stain, hematoxylin and eosin, okay, it's been a while since I said those names out loud, but yeah, H&E stain, they don't normally stain elastin. So you need a special stain to be able to see that. So the black color, the purplish, blackish color right here, that's elastin. And then the pink in between is muscle. All of this is muscle. So the most defining feature of elastic arteries, big elastic arteries, is the fact that the muscle and the elastin fibers are present in a 1:1 ratio. So you can see that the amount of elastin between the sheets, the layers are the same. The number of layers for circular smooth muscles here would be the same as the number of layers for elastin fibers, which is again characteristic of large elastic arteries. Let's move on to a medium-sized artery now. So this is again stained with elastin. So the first thing you see here, let me just first, this is the lumen in the center. Let's orient you guys. This is the tunica intima. We have the tunica media. The tunica adventitia is all of this. This is the purple color, again, is elastin fibers. This is the internal elastic lamina. Right here, these are all smooth muscle cells. I think there's around 30 layers of smooth muscle cells that are present in between the two elastic lamina. Lamina, yeah. And then, this is the external elastic lamina. And then outside of the external elastic lamina, you have all of this connective tissue, all of this right here. And this is all the tunica adventitia. And this is where you would have the nerve supply for these vessels. You would have the blood supply for the vessels. We're gonna talk about that in a bit if you think of this, that's weird. And yeah, so you need I talked about the nerve supply of blood vessels. Why you need that in the first place is for the vasoconstriction and dilation purposes. So controlling, like regulating blood pressure, for instance, that would cause, like you would need to vasoconstrict, right? So to do that, you need a blood supply. You need nerve supply for these arteries. And the nerve supply would be present in the connective tissue of the tunica adventitia. Now this is a small artery. This is a small muscular artery. So this one also has elastin, just like the artery above. Both of these are actually pretty much the same, but there's one key difference. This has elastin as well, but it's not, the elastin is not colored. Like it's not black. Can you tell me why you think this isn't black? Like what's the difference between this and the artery above? That the elastin for this one is not black in color. Less elastin, okay, that's one answer. Does anybody else have anything to say? Only internal, okay. Not really. Different stain, exactly, thank you. Ishra, that was, it's not, this isn't something, this isn't knowledge-based or anything, this is not facts. It's just, you know, a matter of whether or not you really paying attention. So I've talked about elastin stain extensively. So in the first line, there's a lot of elastin stain. Here also, we have elastin stain. We don't have any stain here. This is H&E, there's no stain for the elastin. So you see the wiggly lines right here? All of this is elastin fibers. These are all elastin fibers. This is exactly the same as the artery above. So middle and small sized arteries are almost completely the same. The only real difference between them is the number of layers in the tunica media. So while that had approximately 30 layers, this would have, I guess, like 10 to 15 layers maximum. The wiggly things here are elastin. So that is the internal elastic lamina. And then again, I hope you guys can see this. There's like small, teeny tiny wiggly things here as well. That's the external elastic lamina. So it's pretty much the same thing, honestly. The only difference is the number of layers in the tunica media. So the a medium size would be thicker, more muscular, whereas a smaller artery would not be as muscular. And lastly, we have an arteriole. So arterioles are super, super small. Again, they come right before a capillary, and a capillary is only one cell thick. So they want to make the transition really easy. So an arteriole would only be two cells thick. It only has two layers of muscular cells, muscle cells, and that's pretty much it. I feel like we've already gone over this, but I'll go over it again. So this is what a normal artery would look like. We have the tunica interna right here, which is one cell thick. It's the endothelium. And then we have the basement membrane in yellow here. After the basement membrane, we would have the internal elastic lamina. This is what the tunica intima is made of. The tunica media, which is just muscle, external elastic lamina. And then we have the tunica external. You can see here that there's blood vessels in the tunica externa, and I'll explain that in a bit why that is. So in other words, the internal elastic lamina is separating the tunica interna, so the tunica interna, from the tunica media, whereas the external elastic lamina is separating the media from the adventitia. Just keep that in mind, it's beneficial to know. Let's talk about an elastic artery. So the first picture, let me zoom in for you guys. Okay, number one is the lumen again. This is where the blood would be in a blood vessel. Then this is number two. This is the interna, tunica interna. We have the tunica media, which is number three. Number four is the adventitia. And then you see this really, really small. Let me zoom you guys in right in. Okay. You see how this is so similar to the arterial that I showed you above? It's because it is. It is a blood vessel. And it's so trippy. Like, I know I was confused for the longest time. It's called vasa vasorum, by the way. This is a blood vessel within a blood vessel. So when they're basically, the blood in the lumen right here, it's not enough to sustain the entire length, or you could say the entire thickness of the muscular artery wall. Because when you have a thick muscular juicy artery, the muscle is super thick, right? There's like a lot of muscle. And muscle cells are, they're alive. They need nutrients, they need oxygen, they produce waste products that need to be carried away. So when you have really, really thick arteries, like where the wall is super thick, you need more arteries within them to supply oxygen and nutrients to these arteries, to these muscles, sorry. Because the blood that's actually in the lumen is not enough anymore. How much of the oxygen can actually penetrate all the way to the cells here? Not a lot, right? So we need blood vessels in this area to supply the muscles. This is basically a zoomed in version of that. You see the small rectangle here? This is basically what we're gonna zoom in. This is the lumen of the artery. Number two, it's the, do you see the really, really tiny red flag here? It's sort of pointing at the nucleus. So this, all of this is the endothelium, and the endothelium is always one cell thick. And we have this right here, this sort of thing underneath, that is the subendothelial connective tissue, collagen deposition right underneath the endothelium. Then we have number four, and this is pointing at this wiggly lines. We said the wiggly lines always represent elastin. So wiggly, all of this, all of these wiggly lines would be the internal elastic lamina. And we have number five. And again, this is also pointing at wiggly lines. So this is also the, this is not the internal, but this is elastin that's present throughout the thickness of the wall. Since this is a larger artery, an elastic artery, when you have elastin that's present throughout the blood vessel wall, these are one of the largest arteries, they're elastic arteries. And one of the examples, and an example of such an artery would be the aorta. Then we have number six, this is a cardiomyocyte, and number seven, just like really, really pink looking, it's not really a cell, I don't really see a nucleus, so it's gotta be collagen. This is vasovasorum. So if we were to zoom into this box, we would see this. Now these are blood vessels that are present within the artery that we just talked about. And we know why. We know that the muscular layers need a blood supply of their own to stay alive, to stay viable. And these vasovasorum do exactly that. So we have an artery. The first vessel is an artery, arteriole actually. And this is a... The differences between them, again, lumen. The lumen is so much more wider. It's more relaxed, you know. That would mean it's a vein. And the thickness of the wall is another indicator. That's super thick right here. Whereas over here, it's really thin. Medium-sized artery. I think we talked about this already. Yeah, we did this right here. So I'll skip that slide. Macroscopic artery and vein. Again, this is another slide that's sort of comparing an artery and a vein. So the first thing I want to zoom you guys right in. You can see the wiggly lines again, wiggly lines right here. As soon as you see that, you know that we're talking about elastin. In this case, this is, since it's not present throughout the thickness of the wall, it's just in one single sheet here, not a large artery. So it's most likely either a medium or a small artery. So the lumen is looking very round. The lumen is super round. We have internal elastic lamina. We have a couple layers of smooth muscles. And lastly, we have the connective tissue outside, the tunica externa, versus that of a vein. Versus that of a vein. So we're looking at a very different looking lumen. It's very irregular. It's not round at all. That means it's most likely a vein.
There is no, I'm going to zoom you guys in again. There's no wiggly lines here. So again, no internal elastic lamina, no elastin in general. Veins don't have elastin because they don't need the recoil thing that arteries do, right? Because blood comes in arteries, blood always comes at a higher pressure. You need the arteries to be able to recoil, to bring them back to their original shape, or to be able to expand to accommodate blood at a higher pressure. Veins don't have, it passes from the arteries to the capillaries. The pressure is so low that you don't even, like, the pressure is not even high anymore. So when it goes to the veins from the capillaries, you don't need elastin anymore. So again, there's no elastin. The lumen looks weirdly shaped, I guess. And the muscular, the tunica media, is very thin. Whereas compared to the tunica media, the externa is thicker. So just to go over the key differences again, for the artery, the lumen is circular, whereas for a vein, it's not. The lumen is most likely super haphazard. The elastic lamina, or just like elastin in general, and veins don't. Structure has a lot of muscle. The tunica media is very thick, whereas the media for the vein is thin. It's 2-3 layers maximum. And then lastly, we have the tunica externa, which is thin in the artery, but thicker in the vein. Microscopic arteries and veins. This is pretty much the same thing that I just explained. Yeah, just like different pictures. These capillaries. Okay, so what we're looking at, Dr. Annie basically included like a picture of skin. I don't know how much detail you've taken skin in MSK, but you're going to take it in third year, inshallah, the structure of the skin in more detail. So number one is a capillary, but it's cut cross-sectionally, which is why it's only a circle. Number two is a capillary, but it's longitudinally cut. So one right here, cross-sectionally cut, versus number two, and this is longitudinal, it's cut along length, which is why it looks super long. And we said that capillaries are one cell thick. So you can see, like, you can see how thin they are. And this nucleus on the periphery, this nucleus in number one at the periphery, those are just like features of a capillary. Number three right here is just collagen. This is supposed to be a papillary dermis. Again, you don't have to know what that is. Just know that this pink thing, and there's like no nucleus in it. So you know it's collagen. It's collagen. Number four, ovale cells. These are keratinocytes because we're looking at skin. And five nucleus of the capillary, the endothelial cells. Capillaries of the kidney. So the wherever you see the red flags here, we're gonna do that. And for that. So right here, are you guys following where I'm tracing the laser pointer? That's one capillary. And these pink things you see inside, those are red blood cells. So again, this is another example of a capillary. And these would be red blood cells. What she's basically trying to tell you, like right here, Dr. Annie, that this is a nucleus. And capillaries have their nuclei at the periphery. That's just how endothelial cells are. Okay, we're halfway done. Yay, at 45. Okay, would you guys like to take a break now? We can take a salah break if you want. Yes, okay, awesome. So let's try to be back by 6, 15 minutes. Is that good enough? 15. Okay, let's try to be back by 6 o'clock and we'll continue. It's not gonna take me more than half an hour, I think, inshallah. And then we'll be done with this class, inshallah, inshallah. So, okay, all right, see you guys.
Okay, it's 6:01 and I'm ready to begin again. Give me 1 second, please. So now that we're done with the heart and the blood vessels, we're going to move on to the respiratory tract. We're going to start off by talking about the upper respiratory tract, and in that we'll talk about the nose and the nasal cavity, basically, and the different kinds of epithelium within the nasal cavity, after which we'll talk about the bronchi and the bronchioles and the alveoli. So this is a picture of the nasal cavity. To orient you guys, what we're basically looking at is a cross-section once again, but this time it's, So this right here in the center is the nasal septum. The nasal septum is dividing the two nasal cavities from each other. And this is where I think the nostrils would be technically. We're basically going to be looking at epithelium. So we're going to look at this box right here, and we'll look at this box right here. So the first box, we're going to zoom right into it. This is the box. We're looking at two kinds of epithelium here. We're looking at the first box, which is olfactory epithelium, and we're looking at respiratory epithelium right here. There's key differences between these two, which I'll talk about in just a second, but first we'll describe, each kind in more detail. So olfactory epithelium is basically, let me zoom you guys in. Right here, there's cilia. The entire respiratory tract, it's important to know that it's lined with ciliated cells. So whenever I talk about, so the cells right here are pseudostratified columnar, ciliated is a given, it's a must. The entire respiratory tract is lined with ciliated cells. So I don't even have to mention it, you guys should know. The pink thing right here is cilia. Most of the cells right here are columnar cells, pseudostratified columnar. However, olfactory epithelium, since it's responsible for olfaction, which is knowing the different kinds of smells, it's one of the five senses, so it's like really important. The epithelium is important. So there's going to be more kinds of cells. There's going to be olfactory cells, which is what Dr. Shahid means by ON. That's olfactory epithelium, olfactory cells. They're bipolar in nature, which means that they're more, I think they're more circular in shape. That's what it means. Like the cell right here, just like, for instance. And then lastly, we have basal supporting cells. I'm sorry. Let me just go over that again, because I think it was a little confusing. So BS would mean that we're talking about the basal cells, SC would be supporting cells, and ON is olfactory cells. SC supporting cells is basically the columnar cells I was talking about earlier. Those are the supporting cells. So by supporting, they basically mean that these surrounding cells around the olfactory epithelial cells, they're responsible for like the nutrients and everything that goes to the olfactory epithelium. And like, there's like certain other supporting functions too that the epithelium is responsible for. But by supporting cells, Dr. Shahid would mean columnar cells. That's what the supporting cells means. Then we have olfactory epithelium, bipolar in nature. And then lastly, we have basal cells. This is the nasal cavity, the lumen. This is where the air would come in, obviously. And right from here, all the way till here, this is epithelium, and this is the lamina propria. This is where the glands are present. Again, we need glands. Why you basically need glands is when you, for olfaction specifically, when you're smelling like some sort of an odor, it's going into your nose. What basically happens is that it's going to get dissolved within like the mucus sort of that's present on top of the epithelial cells. And once it dissolves, that's when it goes to the olfactory epithelial cells and produces whatever chemicals and signals that will signal your brain and tell you what kind of smell you're smelling. So the glands are seromucous in nature. So it's seromucous. Sero means watery and mucus is thick. So it's kind of like thinking, it's kind of like watery mucus kind of, and that's going to get secreted all the way over here, basically on the edge. And yeah, the seromucus is basically just to make it easier for you to, for your olfactory epithelial cells to be able to sense different odors.
And that's it. Yeah, so the epithelium and the lamina propria together make the olfactory mucosa. Now we talk about respiratory epithelium. This is pretty simple. This is the epithelium that basically lines the majority of your respiratory tract. So we have the epithelium right here. There's obviously the fuzzy pink border that you see here. That's all of that is cilia. And these are columnar in nature. So you see ciliated pseudostratified columnar cells with the occasional goblet cells. So like the transparent cells you would see here and there, they're all goblet cells. Then we have the lamina propria, which is connective tissue. And most here as well, just like the one that I was talking about earlier, lamina propria here has glands as well. So these are the glands. These are the acini, they look like flowers. I'm pretty sure Dr. Annie's explained, you know, how glands look like flowers and that they're called acini. So yeah, epithelium right here, lamina propria, together they make the respiratory mucosa. Comparing olfactory and respiratory epithelium. So this is where I'm going to be telling you the key differences between the two kinds. We know that both of them have pseudostratified columnar cells. They both have cilia. They both also have glands. They both have seromucous glands in their lamina propria to produce, you know, to make sure that the lining stays moist. But the key difference right here is if you were to look at the olfactory epithelium, the cells are very haphazard because of the fact that there's three different kinds present. So we said that there's the supporting cells, which are the tall columnar cells. We said there's basal cells, and there's also the olfactory epithelium, the bipolar olfactory epithelial cells. These are three different kinds, and they're all different shapes. So the bipolar olfactory cells are more circular in nature, for instance. The basal cell would be a little bit more cuboidal, and then we have tall columnar cells, which is the supporting cells. As a result of which, they don't really fit in together really well. So you can see that it's all like really, it's messy. It's very haphazard. Whereas for respiratory epithelium, you can see that, you know, all of them are columnar at least. The cells are still messy, but they're all columnar in nature. One other difference that you can sort of tell is that the olfactory epithelium does not contain goblet cells. There is no goblet cells that are present here. Most of the, like, there's no mucus. We have watery mucus, which is seromucus, but there's no actual mucus. Whereas for respiratory epithelium, we need that. So there's going to be goblet cells present here, but none in the olfactory epithelium. Okay, quick recap. Key differences between olfactory and respiratory epithelium. Presence of goblet cells in respiratory, but not in olfactory. And olfactory epithelium looking more haphazard than respiratory epithelium because of the different kinds of cells that are present. Okay, now we talk about the lower respiratory tract. We're looking at the trachea here, the trachea and the lungs. So the bronchi, the bronchioles, and the alveoli. Okay, this is the trachea and the esophagus. The trachea and the esophagus anatomically in your body, they're placed literally next to each other. So we have the trachea anteriorly, I think. I'm not sure. You guys would know better. I'm third, but I don't even remember all of this. I'm 30 year now. So we have the trachea anteriorly, I think, and the esophagus posteriorly. I could be wrong, honestly. Don't take me for this. But they're basically present really close to each other. The trachea, how you know this is the trachea, not the esophagus, is this purplish structure right here. So you see this purplish structure, the one that I'm pointing at? All of this is cartilage. And you can see the cartilage sort of cuts off right here. And it sort of ends right here as well. So it's C-shaped. So this entire thing, this is C-shaped. We already know the trachea has C-shaped rings of cartilage to hold it open at all times, which is why the lumen is completely open. Whereas the lumen for the esophagus is kind of collapsed almost because you're not eating all the time. So your esophagus isn't open all the time. Whereas with the trachea, it needs to be open. You need to be breathing all the time, right? In the trachea picture, it's the trachealis muscle. And yeah, that's pretty much it. The esophagus is also like what I'm pointing at right now. The esophagus is way muscular than the trachea is, again, because you need it for peristalsis. Whereas the trachea is open all the time. You don't need to be, you know, there's no peristalsis, none of that sort. So you don't need a proper defined muscle. And yeah, that's how you differentiate a trachea and the esophagus. This is trachea. This is a cross section once again, but this is a trachea cut in half. That's why it looks C-shaped. And we're gonna talk about each of the different kinds of layers. So first of all, we have, starting from the lumen outwards, we have the mucosa. The mucosa consists of epithelium. In this case, it's respiratory epithelium. You can see this really, really clear thing right here. That's a goblet cell. Ciliated pseudostratified columnar epithelium, along with the basement membrane and some lamina propria, that would be the mucosa. Then we move on to the submucosa. All of these, again, acini, flower-shaped acini, are all glands. And again, the glands are producing mucus, they're producing serous fluid to line and lubricate the trachea. Why do we need mucus in the trachea? To obviously trap dust and to trap any like bacteria, pathogens, anything of that sort. The submucosa doesn't only have the glands, it also has like this portion right here, and this is the perichondrium. So basically the hyaline cartilage that you see here, the hyaline cartilage, it has a sheath of connective tissue around it, and that's called the perichondrium. So the submucosa is made up of the glands as well as the perichondrium. Then you have the actual cartilage, the C-shaped cartilage rings. How you know that's cartilage? Once again, it's purple in color. It's a very different sort of appearance. It's almost like jelly looking, you can say, like the purple in between the lacuna. That's how you know you're looking at cartilage. And another feature that you should know would be like these lacuna, yeah. And there's chondrocytes present within them. This again is the perichondrium. This is connective tissue, which is surrounding the cartilage. And lastly, we have the adventitia. This is connective tissue, obviously adventitia. And this connective tissue would contain, you know, nerve supply and blood supply. As always, connective tissue always contains vasculature, the vascular supply of the organ that the connective tissue is surrounding, and the nerve supply. And that's pretty much it for this slide. This is the tracheal mucosa respiratory epithelium. Okay, this is basically this thing right here, the mucosa. We've taken a section of that and we've magnified it under the microscope, and this is what we see. So fuzzy pink at the edge of the lumen, this has to be cilia, cilia. These are ciliated columnar pseudostratified cells. Right here, the transparent looking cells would be goblet cells. They're producing mucus. We have basal cells as well, right here, basal cells, the BC. This pink collagenous tissue, this would be the basement membrane. So we have epithelium, we have basement membrane, and then we have the lamina propria, and all of these things together, all these components together, would form the respiratory mucosa. Tracheal submucosa. I've sort of already explained this. So again, it's just the glands. The submucosa would be the glands, the acinar looking, you know, flower-shaped glands. And then we have the perichondrium, which is the connective tissue that surrounds the trachea, the tracheal cartilage, sorry. Now we look at bronchi. So this picture is really great in that it shows the entire structure, like all the different bronchi, bronchioles, alveolar ducts, everything. It's summarized in this one big picture. So this right here, the first box right here, this is a segmental bronchus. This is a bronchi, and it's big. Then we move on to a bronchiole. So this is a larger bronchiole, and this is a smaller bronchiole. And then we have these structures. There's so many red flags here. These structures right here, we have terminal and respiratory bronchial. We have the alveolar duct and the alveolar sac, this bigger one. We have zoomed in pictures. I'll talk about it more once we get onto those pictures. And the really teeny tiny circles would be the alveoli. As sort of to refresh you guys' memory, just as a recap, we go from the trachea. The trachea splits into two. It forms the bronchi, the main bronchi. These would give you segmental bronchi, which will go to the different segments of the lungs, of the lobes of the lungs. Segmental bronchi would divide further to give you larger bronchioles. Larger bronchioles, and then they form smaller bronchioles, which will then form terminal bronchioles, respiratory bronchioles, alveolar ducts, alveolar sacs, and finally the alveoli. So So this is the first bronchus, the one in the box right here. This is the first one that we're seeing, looking at right now. This bronchus is split into two sections. There's like more smooth muscles on one side and more cartilage on the other side. And we're going to look at magnified pictures of both. Okay. So this is the smooth muscle portion. This is the upper portion of that bronchus we were talking about. So let's zoom you guys in. You see all these red flags that are visible? This red flag right here, this red flag. All of this is muscles. All of this that are surrounding the entire bronchus, these are all smooth muscles. Something else that is characteristic of this bronchus is cartilage. For this section right here, this picture was labeled, Dr. Shahin labeled cartilage on this picture. I don't really personally see it, but there's supposed to be like some cartilage on, like, where I'm pointing at, there's supposed to be some cartilage here. Like, I personally can't really see it. I don't know. But there is, it's like better seen in one of the later pictures, so I'll explain what it looks like. So cartilage, we have smooth muscles, we have glands in this area, teeny tiny glands. And lastly, we have lymphoid tissue. Lymphoid tissue is better visible, again, on the other side right here. So this right here, lymph, it's labeled lymph. This is lymphoid tissue. What lymphoid tissue is that it's an aggregation of lots and lots of lymphocytes. You guys haven't taken HLS yet, I think. Yeah. When you do take HLS, you'll look at all the different kinds of white blood cells and their appearance under your microscope. So lymphocytes are basically a kind of white blood cell where the nucleus is humongous. Nucleus is basically the entire cell. It's spanning the entire width of the cell, you know? So since nuclei stain a little bit darker, a little bit more blue, the entire cell appears to be blue. And as you can see here, all of the cells look like they're blue. You can see an aggregation of blue cells. When you see that, wherever it is, it's most likely lymphoid tissue. The first thing that should pop into your mind when you see lots of blue cells collected together, it's lymphoid tissue, okay? Then we move on to cartilage, right here, CT. It's cartilage, why? Like I explained earlier, it has a jelly-like, not texture, but a jelly-like appearance to it. And then there's the circles, the lacuna, which contain chondrocytes. This is another one of the cartilage. Another picture where you can see a cartilage. And lastly, there's these glands that are very characteristic of a main bronchus. Sorry, segmental bronchus. Okay, so we've talked about the first picture, the bronchus. We said that it had some defining characteristics, such as a really thick smooth muscle. It had cartilage. It had lymphoid tissue. It had glands, connective tissue. It had all that good stuff. A lot of things. That's why it's so thick, right? Now we're going to move on to the bronchial. So this was a larger bronchial. This is a smaller bronchial. And we'll look at it in more detail. There we go. It's zoomed in. So the blue arrows here, these blue arrows, are pointing at the epithelium. So as we go down the respiratory tract, the pseudostratified columnar epithelium actually becomes simple columnar, which is actually the most common in small bronchioles. And then simple columnar will become simple cuboid as it moves on. So right here, this is a mix of, I think it's a mix of cuboidal and columnar epithelium, basically. All of this towards the inside, but this is not pseudostratified columnar, that's for sure. In the bronchial, other than the cuboidal cells, we also have, in the smaller bronchioles, you now have clara cells. Clara cells are basically cells that secrete a lot of surfactant. So you guys already know what surfactant is for, right? So it's basically supposed to coat the inside of the lungs, the alveoli, and what it does is it's responsible for making sure lungs don't collapse when you breathe out. And then the red arrows point towards connective tissue and muscles. So right here, there's aggregates of smooth muscle, right here, smooth muscle, right here, and connective tissue. Comparison of bronchus and bronchioles. So a side-by-side comparison, when we look at it, we can see that we talked about the lymphoid aggregate, the lymphoid tissue with the bronchi, but there is none with the bronchial. There's no lymphoid tissue. There's no aggregation of lymphocytes present in the bronchial. Another differentiating feature would be cartilage. So we saw here, we saw cartilage. We saw cartilage in this picture right here on the bronchi, but there is no cartilage present in the bronchial. There's no cartilage in this entire bronchial. Lastly, we also saw glands, if you remember, really teeny tiny, like circular glands, but there were none in the bronchial. So these are the three things that differ between a bronchus versus a bronchial: the presence of cartilage, the presence of lymphoid tissue, and lastly, the presence of glands, like mucus secreting glands. Now we move on to respiratory epithelium, respiratory bronchioles. These are really, really teeny tiny. Let's look at it zoomed in. There we go. So after the entire division of the bronchi, segmental bronchi, bronchioles occurs, it will form the terminal bronchial. Once it forms the terminal one, it will form respiratory bronchial. Now this is where we still have columnar cells. The cells are not, they're not pseudostratified, of course. After the bronchioles, you're not going to have pseudostratified cells. That's because pseudostratified cells are like, it looks like there's multiple layers, and it's kind of thick. The epithelium is thick, and we don't want that. As we go towards the alveoli, we want to make sure that the epithelium goes thinner and thinner and thinner so that we can go to the alveoli where it's super thin, so that it's very easy for gaseous exchange to take place. So carbon dioxide and oxygen can diffuse in and out, like without having to travel the entire thickness of an epithelium, right? So we just, like, as we're traveling down, we're making sure that the epithelium is getting thinner and thinner and thinner. So for respiratory bronchial, the most important kind of epithelium present here would be a cuboidal epithelium. So it's not even columnar anymore, it's cuboidal, which is a cuboidal cell would be, in theory, it would be shorter than a columnar cell, right? So air would have to travel a less amount of distance, oxygen or carbon dioxide. Other than cuboidal cells present within the respiratory bronchioles, we have Clara cells, again, surfactant, and we know what surfactant does. Towards the outside, so we talk about the inside, epithelium. Let's talk about the outside. So it contains smooth muscles. Again, smooth muscles, but now, again, we're moving down. We're going towards thin, thin, thin. And so the amount of smooth muscles present in the respiratory bronchial is very less. There's a few elastin fibers that are present here as well. I think it's mostly the elastin fibers function later on, really deep in the lungs, would probably be to prevent collapse. Because like these smaller structures would be more prone to collapsing once you breathe out. When we don't want that, so we want to give them the function of recoil, which is given by the elastin fibers. Then we have the alveolar duct, which again is even further down the line. So technically, it doesn't even have cuboidal cells anymore. The cells are now squamous. Squamous is the thinnest kind of cell. That's perfect for gaseous exchange, right? And towards the outside, we have connective tissue and elastin again. And the connective tissue is now even, no, not connective, sorry, smooth muscle cells. The smooth muscle cell is now even thinner in terms of diameter. So again, to aid gaseous exchange. Then we have alveolar sacs and these cute small little alveoli, the ones that are labeled A. Alveolar ducts, we've already talked about that. Now we talk about the kinds of alveolar cells. Let's zoom you guys in. Okay, the blue arrows indicate, so the cell that you see with the blue arrow, it's really thin. The ends look like they're pulled outwards. It's spindle-shaped, which means, and the nucleus is elongated as well, which means it's a squamous cell. Squamous cell, when you see a squamous cell lining the alveoli, this is most likely pneumocyte type 1. And then we have the red arrows, which would indicate pneumocyte type 2, and these are cuboidal cells. Right here. These are cuboidal cells. And pneumocyte type 2 is also responsible for secreting surfactant. So just like Clara cells, pneumocyte type 2, these are the two kinds of cells that would be secreting surfactant in the lungs. Other than that, pneumocyte type 2 forms the majority of the cells in the lungs. It's just the one that's like more prominent. It's the majority, around 70%, I think, of cells are type 2, whereas the rest of the 30% would be type 1. The green arrows here point towards macrophages. So this cell right here, this is like, you can tell that this is like too big to be like a cuboidal cell that's lining the alveoli, and they look bigger than all the rest of the cells. So that's indicative of the fact that these are macrophages. And they're present
in the alveoli for the same reasons that we had lymphoid tissue earlier on, mostly so that whatever bacteria and pathogens that you've inhaled in into your respiratory tract, they're effectively removed and killed off.
So we mentioned how lymphoid tissue, like there's no lymphoid tissue later on. Instead of lymphoid tissue, we now have macrophages. I think this is pretty much the last slide. And we're looking at, so this is the same picture from above. We have the bronchiole. This is the large bronchiole, the small bronchiole. This is what we just looked at in so much detail. This is the periphery of the entire lung, all of this. And this is the visceral pleura. So just like we had a pericardial cavity, we also have pleural cavity. And it also is made up of the same serous fluid. So serous fluid is always secreted by mesothelial cells. So the red arrows right here on the edge, they're all mesothelial cells. And yeah, that's it. We're done. That was an hour and a half approximately. That was a really good amount of time. I think a few of your batchmates requested that we do questions. So let's do practice questions. Does cartilage come first or smooth muscle? Zane, what could you please elaborate? What are you talking about? Where, like what structure? You're welcome, Iman. I'm so glad to be helping out. You're welcome, Sandra. I'm so glad it helped. Inshallah, yeah, the video will be uploaded. For bronchus, for a trachea. Does muscularis come first or smooth muscle? Muscularis would come first because muscularis mucosa is part of the actual mucosa, right? So epithelium, lamina propria, mucosa, and then, let me repeat. Epithelium, lamina propria, muscularis mucosa, that comes first, and then the smooth muscle will come later on. Do both Clara cells and type 1 pneumocytes do the same function, just in different locations? As far as I'm aware, yeah, both of them secrete the same surfactant. But they could be doing other things. It's honestly been a while since I did this. So as far as I'm aware, both of them secrete surfactant. So they have this similar function, but they could be doing more something else as well that sort of differentiates between them. I have one question. Does cartilage come first or smooth muscle for the bronchus? Let me scroll up. So this is the bronchus. I think the smooth muscle would come first. Because the smooth muscle, as you can see in this picture, the smooth muscle is like adherent to the actual epithelium of the bronchus, right? Whereas if you see the cartilage is kind of further away. And this is, I'm pretty sure this is the muscle, the smooth muscle layer. And the cartilage is further away. So I'm pretty sure the cartilage would be further away versus smooth muscle, which is right next to the epithelium. Do you guys have any other questions? What did you say about the lymphoid tissue in bronchioles and bronchi? Okay, let me pull up a picture. So the picture on my left-hand side is a bronchus, whereas on my right, we have the bronchiole. Over here, you see lymphoid tissue. Once again, lymphoid tissue is an aggregation of lymphocytes, which is a kind of white blood cell. Lymphocytes, the ones in this picture at least, they have a very large nucleus, which is blue in color, and that's why you see blue cells. And the nucleus is very large, which stains the entire cell blue. In terms of bronchial, there is no lymphoid tissue. This is one of the differentiating factors between a bronchus and a bronchial. The fact that a bronchus would contain lymphoid tissue, whereas a bronchial would not. Can you give a quick recap about the vasovisorum? Yep, of course. Vasovisorum, okay. So what we're basically looking at is, I think this picture is better. So this is an elastic artery. How do we know this is elastic? If you were to zoom in, this is not as good a picture. So if you were to zoom in, this is the zoomed in picture. If you were to zoom in, you would be able to see the wiggly lines. So there is elastin present, and the elastin is not just limited to the endothelium, it's actually present throughout the thickness, which means that we are in an elastic artery. This is not a medium-sized artery, this is not a small-sized artery, which contain only internal and external elastic lamina. When it spans the entire thickness, it is a large elastic artery. So using this picture, number five right here is the vasovasorum. So in terms of concept of vasovasorum, it's basically when you have a really thick blood vessel, like the aorta, for instance, the wall of the aorta is super thick, right? And it has muscles. Normally for smaller blood vessels, the blood that's present within the lumen right here, that's enough to sustain the actual blood vessel. Because the blood vessel consists of cells. These cells are alive, they need nutrients, they need oxygen. Normally the blood in the lumen, the oxygen will just diffuse across and that would be enough. However, when you have a really thick blood vessel, the wall is super thick, what the problem is that oxygen wouldn't be able to diffuse all the way across. Since there's so much muscle, there's so many cells, and the oxygen that does diffuse through is not enough for the cells that are at the periphery. So what we do, we have more blood vessels. So just consider the large elastic artery as an organ. It has cells, it needs a blood supply of its own. So you have the vasovasorum right here, number five. This is responsible for supplying blood to the muscularis layer, to the adventitia layer, so that, you know, no cell death occurs. They keep getting their nutrients, their waste products are removed, etc. I hope that answers your question. Can you repeat the visceral pleura? Yep, once again. In terms of histology, you don't really need to know a lot about the visceral pleura. This is more anatomy. But the visceral pleura, so basically the lungs, just like the heart, it's exactly like the heart. You know, the heart is encapsulated by this, basically there's a sandwich of layers outside of the heart, which contains the pericardial cavity, right? So there's serous pericardium. In terms of serous pericardium, you have the parietal layer and the visceral. The visceral is what's closest to the heart, because visceral means organ. Just think of it like that. So visceral is the layer that's closer to the heart versus the parietal, which is on the outside. Just like exactly the same thing happening around the lungs as well. So you have the pleural cavity, which is when you have a visceral pleural membrane around the actual lungs. Then you have the pleural cavity. And then the other layer that encapsulates it would be the parietal pleura. I hope that answers your question. What was the second structure in the second slide for vasovasorum? Do you mean second structure? Do you mean in the vasovasorum slide? The second structure. Do you mean this picture? If this is the picture you mean, I can explain to you what this is. So they took this small section. This is a really large elastic artery. They took the periphery, because like I said, the blood that flows through the lumen, that's enough to sustain the part that's closed. But the part that's furthest away, this does not get oxygen. So you need blood vessels to supply oxygen here. This is an artery, an arteriole actually. It's not an actual artery. But this is an arteriole, and this is the muscular layer. It's super thick, and the lumen is circular, which will tell you that this is an arteriole. And then we have a venule right here, where the lumen is like really, relaxed, sort of haphazard. It's not really proper and circular. And the thickness is not really a lot, which means that there's not a lot of muscle present. And that's the defining feature of a venule. So yeah, vasovasorum, arterioles, venules that supply the actual artery. So pneumocytes type 2 are cuboidal in shape and type 1 are flat. Is that right? Let me show you a picture really quick. Okay, yeah. So pneumocytes type 1 are flat. Yep, exactly. And type 2 are cuboidal in shape. Exactly. So cuboidal, red arrows point towards the cuboidal one, which is type 2, produce surfactant. Whereas type 1 is squamous and does not produce surfactant. You're welcome, Jenna. I'm so glad to help. Do you guys have any other questions? If not, we can start doing the questions. So here's the questions. The first question is, identify the tissue and where can we find it? What layer, what organ? Would anybody like to volunteer to answer? Just you can type your answers in the chat. Cardiac muscle, exactly. Identify the tissue, cardiac muscle, where can we find it from? Yeah. Give one unique identification point, ICDs, exactly. Intercalated discs, exactly. Striated, yeah. So striated is not really unique to the heart. Like I've explained earlier, that the skeletal muscle is also striated. So it's not really unique, but the intercalated discs are unique. The fact that you see branching is also unique. Binucleations are also unique to the cardiac muscle. Branching, exactly, awesome. Let's see the answers. Cardiac muscle tissue in myocardium, intercalated discs. Awesome, okay. Question number two. Identify the letter E, and what is the function of D? Elastic lamina, no, not really. So try to keep in mind that we're not in the blood vessel right now. This is the heart. Cardiac myocyte junction, exactly. Purkinje myocyte junction, yep. Awesome, thank you. What is the function of D? So this is a cross-section. Remember how I, Sandra, remember how I showed you the cross-section of one cardiomyocyte? It was very similar to this, right? This whole muscle cell. And then these are Purkinje fiber cells. And these are present in the heart, so an elastic lamina are present in the blood vessels. So just make sure you're not confusing the two. Purkinje myocyte. And then the functions would be autorhythmicity and conducting action potentials. What is the name of the structure below? Functional name of the structure. Elastic artery, yeah. Conducting artery, oh. I mean, elastic artery is correct as well, but conducting artery, what they mean by that is that it conducts blood from the heart. It's in Dr. Annie's slides, but yeah, I didn't think it was that important, but okay, conducting artery. Name of the vessel and analogous vein. Arterial, exactly, that's the arterial, awesome. So they're really small, and you can see like a couple nuclei, just two layers of muscle cells, that's the arterial. Muscular venule, awesome. Oops, okay. Which one is olfactory mucosa? Is it A or is it B? A, exactly. Yay, good job, you guys, you're doing so well. Identify the epithelium that is shown in red. I can zoom in if you guys want. Respiratory epithelium, let's look at the answer. Oh, that's what I meant. Pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium. Most of the kind of respiratory epithelium is pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium. So you guys were right. I will still give you a point. Good job, Sidra and Zane. Identify the organ and epithelium. The trachea. Okay, good job, Zayfa. Yep, that's a trachea. Respiratory, pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium with goblet cells. Name the structure below. Identify the structure that is shown in the red arrow. Bronchial lymphoid, yep, bronchus, lymph, intrapulmonary bronchi, bronchus. Yay, awesome, you guys are great. Bronchus and lymphatic, basically lymphoid tissue, yeah. Now, this is the last question. What type of cell is shown in the red arrow? Let me zoom in for you guys and state its function. Type 2 alveolar, type 2. Type 2 pneumocytes make surfactant. Awesome. Let's look at the answers. Yay, pneumocyte type 2, they're cuboidal cells, and they make surfactant. Awesome. I'm so proud of you guys. You guys did so well, mashallah. And you were so attractive. That's lovely to see. Yeah, we're done.
Do you guys have any other questions?
You're welcome. I'm so glad to help you guys. I'm so, so glad that it helped.
This makes me so happy.
Yay. You're very welcome, everybody.
Again, like I've linked my, I sent you guys my slide and my email address is linked in it. So if you guys have any questions, you can send me an email. I will, inshallah, get it back to you as soon as possible.
And that's it. If you guys don't have any questions, you are free to leave.
Have a good day and best of luck. Inshallah, you guys will do really, really well.